Welcome to A Look Ahead. We're delighted that you've decided to join us. You probably know by now that we study the Sabbath school lessons as prepared by the Seventh-day Adventist Church, and this particular series is about the book of Matthew. It's a series for April, May, and June of 2016, and this particular lesson is lesson number 4 in that series for April 23 of 2016, entitled, Get Up and Walk, Faith and Healing. That's an interesting title. What can we do with that? Well, let's see. We like to begin, we hope you have your Bible handy, we like to begin with a word of prayer. Our wonderful Father, we come recognizing your presence once again as we open the scriptures and seek to understand your word. May the Holy Spirit be very close to us and to all the listeners who are out there scattered around the world, that they may, from the words that are spoken, hear you. From your word, speak to them with our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
There's no question about the fact that the time when Jesus was alive here and ministering here on this earth, there were more miracles performed than probably at any other time in history. I don't think there's any question about that. And just think of some of the kinds of miracles he performed, right? Cleansing lepers, I mean, just in terms of personal things. Raising people from the dead, but then things like calming deadly storms and casting out demons. He reminds us through all these things his incredible power over anything demonic. And I guess I should ask, do you think disease is sometimes demonic?
Sure.
God isn't the author of it. Creator isn't okay. The author of it, but it's...
Try to think of some of the scariest, the worst possible things that you can imagine. I'm sure that most of us would probably put on the list our own death and maybe the death of some of our near relatives. But think of that same list in God's sight. How does God look at human death, what we call the first death?
He puts them to sleep.
It's just asleep. And what's he going to do?
Raise him, wake him up.
He's going to wake up every one of those people at some time in the future. So to God, it's just asleep. So loss of eternal life is a much more serious matter in God's sight than in the loss of this life. We know that Jesus healed many, many people during his ministry on this earth. He even told his children, his disciples, think of them as children. Jesus, he even told his disciples to raise people from the dead, didn't he? Do you think they actually did that? Well, we know some of them did later, didn't they? Excuse me. Steps to Christ, page 11, paragraph 2, tells us that he sometimes would pass through villages and not a single person was left sick after he passed through the village. Try to imagine what would happen if Jesus suddenly appeared and walked through a town and healed everybody today, maybe in our hospital over here. How do you think people would respond? Excuse me. Go ahead.
I say the management would have serious problem with it.
Well,
it's a little cynical.
Of course it is.
They'd be overwhelmed, is what they'd be. Overwhelmed by more people.
That's right.
But I think they'd say, oh, we get a rest for a while.
Yeah, sure.
Don't we have to be a little careful there? I'm not saying it couldn't happen. But where do you draw the line between the technologies that we use here every day that they never had in Christ's time?
Yeah.
Versus what the devil would like to do. Now, I can see the devil getting into this place and coming in and saying, I'm Christ. That, I think,
wow.
Is... I mean, we know it's coming. I'm not saying we can't have miracles ourselves. If you have known anyone that's been in the mission fields and some of the back blocks, there's been miracles. There's no question.
Mm-hmm.
But I wonder about, you know, in our situation, in our society, the way it is at the moment.
What happened to those people that Jesus, even the ones he raised from the dead? Lazarus, what finally happened to him?
He died again.
He died again, yeah. Do we have any exceptions to that in the ministry of Christ? during the time he was here on this earth? They're very interesting couple of paragraphs found in Desire of Ages, page 786, paragraphs 1 through 3. But those who came forth from the grave at Christ's resurrection were raised to everlasting life. They ascended with him as trophies of his victory over death and the grave. These, said Christ, are no longer the captives of Satan. I have redeemed them. I have brought them from the grave as the first fruits of my power to be with me where I am, never more to see death or experience sorrow. These went into the city. I want you to think about this now. These went into the city. What city would that be?
Jerusalem.
Jerusalem, yeah. And appeared unto many, declaring, Christ has risen from the dead, and we be risen with him. Now, what's the Hebrew word or the Aramaic word for Christ?
Messiah or Mashiach?
Yeah, the Messiah. The Messiah has risen from the dead. I mean, how would the Jews respond to a message like that? Thus was immortalized the sacred truth of the resurrection. It would be very interesting to know who was chosen to be raised. Were they just people who happened to die close to Jerusalem for whatever reason? We don't know who he chose or why. It says, if you read carefully there, it seems to be that the earthquake that happened at Jesus' death threw open the graves and even cast some of the bodies out of the graves, supposedly. And then at the resurrection, they were raised to life, which is an interesting sequence of things. Okay, well, there are many today who look back on the healing ministry of Jesus and wish they had the power to duplicate those healings. I think you all here already know the story of a Christian evangelist who claimed that one day, he's going to have a resurrection from the dead on live TV, and when that happens, he's going to convert the whole world.
He's gone now.
He's waiting to resurrect himself.
That guy that I think you're referring to is gone now.
Yeah, I know. He didn't manage to heal himself, huh?
Well, that's no big deal. Doesn't the prophecy say that everybody's going to be resurrected?
Well, yeah.
Well, not everybody's going to be converted.
No.
Because they're resurrected.
No. It's important to remember as we look at these biblical texts that the word for healing in Greek, sozo, is exactly the same as the word for saving or salvation. So let's take some examples. Look at Leviticus 13, 44 to 50 as a little background. The priest, this is someone comes with a rash. The priest shall pronounce him unclean because of the dreaded skin disease on his head. Now my Good News Bible calls that a dreaded skin disease. This is Leviticus 13, 44 to 50. The Good News, I mean the King James and earlier versions call it, of course, leprosy. A person who has a dreaded skin disease must wear torn clothes, leave his hair uncombed, cover the lower part of his face, and call out, unclean, unclean, unclean. He remains unclean as long as he has the disease, and he must live outside the camp away from others. And then it goes on down here, and finally it says that if he ever thinks he gets well, he must go and try to present an offering to the priest. And the priest, before he can accept the offering, must be proclaim him clean, okay? So that helps to understand what we're going to read next. What did Jesus do right after he had the Sermon on the Mount? Do you remember? When Jesus came, this is Matthew 8 now. When Jesus came down from the hill, large crowds followed him. Then a man suffering from a dreaded skin disease came to him, knelt down before him and said, Sir, if you want to, you can make me clean. Jesus stretched out his hand and touched him. I do want to, he answered, be clean. At once the man was healed of his disease. Then Jesus said to him, Listen, don't tell anyone, but go straight to the priest and let him examine you. Then in order to prove to everyone that you are cured, offer the sacrifice that Moses ordered. When Jesus entered Capernaum, a Roman officer, well, that goes on to the next miracle.
That's interesting. You point out that the uncleanness was a disease, mm-hmm. and in the Old Testament, sin is described as a disease, mm-hmm. and God, was it Exodus 15, 26, he says, I'm your healer, mm-hmm. and salvation is healing.
Yeah, so fits together.
But it isn't an issue of forgiveness. Forgiveness is not a requirement.
No. The word the man used, you can make me clean, can make, is the word dunamai, from which we get what word?
Power.
Dynamite.
But it refers exactly. to the power to heal me.
The guy said, Jesus, you've got the dynamite it takes to make the difference. Think of all the people who were following Jesus in those days. What did they think when Jesus touched that leper? Surely Jesus could have healed the leper by just speaking, so why did he touch him? And here's Mrs. White's comments. The work of Christ in cleansing the leper from his terrible disease is an illustration of his work in cleansing the soul from sin. The man who came to Jesus was full of leprosy. The deadly poison permeated his whole body. The disciples sought to prevent their master from touching him. Why did they want to prevent their master from touching him?
He would be unclean.
Yeah, according to Jewish law, he would be unclean. For he who touched a leper became himself unclean. But in laying his hand upon this leper, Jesus received no defilement. His touch imparted life-giving power. The leprosy was cleansed. Thus it is with the leprosy of sin, deeply deep-rooted, deadly, and impossibly to be cleansed by human power. Desire of Ages 266.1. And there's an interesting note that goes along with that on page 54 of our Adult Teacher Sabbath School Bible Study Guide. Unclean, unclean was the leper's required cry in order to keep all passers-by at a distance. Physical decay and deformity, social ostracism, and communal isolation made the lepers the living dead. They were society's untouchables. According to rabbinical law, at least 6 feet of distance should separate them from any other human being. To break this boundary was to become unclean, requiring rigorous purification ceremonies overseen by a priest. Against such a background, our story is set. The leper knew that Jesus is the Lord and that he had the power to make him whole. But how would he bridge the gap? 6 feet was a long and forbidden distance for a leper to cross in the journey to that saving point where healing stands. But the faith of the leper closed the space, and to his cry instantly came the answer, I am willing, be cleansed. So back to my question. Was Jesus contaminated by touching the leper?
No, the leprosy was contaminated by being touched with Jesus.
What do you mean by that?
Well, the power went the other way.
Mm-hmm. So, I mean, imagine the priests were waiting. I'm sure they would have loved to. Oh, he's contaminated. Get away from him. You know, Jesus is contaminated. But as soon as he touched the man,
there's no leprosy
there. There's no leprosy there. So
contaminate him.
What do you say? Well, who would be lepers in our day? Now, I used to work with lepers in Africa. And, saw lots of them.
Yes.
Touched them many times. We used to do surgery on them to help try to make them so they could live better lives. Are there modern-day lepers of sin in our day? What would be a leper of sin?
Well, like you said, they're kind of the living dead. The body is kind of deteriorating like a dead body, actually, mm-hmm. only they're alive. So that would say something about people who are immersed in sin.
Yeah. Well, look at the next story. Actually, let me just interrupt for a second. There's a very interesting story told in the teacher section of our lesson for this week about Valora Mission College. There's a hospital and a college there in India. And someone realized that these lepers were being destroyed because they were walking around without any shoes on. They were cutting themselves and so forth. And they didn't realize it because their feet were numb. So they invented this process whereby they took a certain kind of rubber product and they blew it full of really tiny little air bubbles. And these air bubbles don't connect to each other in any way. They're somehow or other, they kept them separate so that they made a little cushion about maybe half an inch thick and the rubber was almost impossible to wear out. And so they made sandals. They would take rubber from old tires, and they would put this cushion rubber on top of it, glue it on there, make a leather cover to top the shoes. And these things will last almost indefinitely. And they were wonderful, wonderful sandals. But as soon as the lepers around Valor started wearing them, all the restaurants said, aha, we know who the lepers are. We're not going to let you in here. So you know what happened? Pretty soon all the staff at Valor started wearing the leper sandals. And then the restaurant people were in a real quandary. What are we going to do? We don't want to get rid of all these people who have money that could come in the restaurant. So finally they dropped their abhorrence to the leper sandals. And I will tell you that I had the privilege when I was in Mwami Hospital in Zambia, we managed to import a bunch of that special special rubber, and made the sandals, and I wore them for years when I was in Africa. They were wonderful sandals. It's too bad somebody here doesn't figure that out and make them here. Anyway, going on to our next story, Matthew 8, 5 to 13. Remember that story? When Jesus entered Capernaum, a Roman officer met him and begged for help. Sir, my servant is sick in bed at home, unable to move, and suffering terribly. Now, if you put all the Gospels together, I'm not going to take time to do it right now, and Ellen White does it very well. She says, actually, the Roman centurion thought he wasn't worthy to be in Jesus' presence, so he sent some people to Jesus saying, please come, my servant is dying. So Jesus starts off for the man's house, or the centurion's house. And the centurion says, I'm not worthy to have this powerful guy stay in my house. So he sent some more people. He said, you don't need to come, just say the word. And Jesus kept on coming. Finally, the centurion himself came. And that's the part we have here in Matthew. I will go and make him well, Jesus said. Oh, no, sir, answered the officer. I do not deserve to have you come into my house. Just give the order and my servant will get well. I, too, am a man under the authority of superior officers, and I have soldiers under me. I order this one, go, and he goes. And I order that one, come, and he comes. And I order my slave, do this, and he does it. When Jesus heard this, he was surprised and said to the people following him, I tell you, I have never found anyone in Israel with faith like this. So now, you know what my question is going to be, don't you? How did he get that faith?
Well, I would say observation initially. Romans all over the place.
He had never seen Jesus before.
He would have heard about him.
Yeah. And so you're saying that he developed his faith in Jesus by hearing about him.
Heard the words of truth, and it was receptive to it.
Okay. Is that any clue for us?
Oh, well, Romans 2:14 and 15 basically says the same thing. When those who don't have the law do what the law requires, so that the law is written on their heart. And the requirement of the law is what? Love? Something God can't force, but that's fulfilling of the law.
What about Romans, which also says faith comes by
hearing?
Hearing.
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, he could have had the Spirit. The Spirit tells people things that are a little bit, that don't come through the normal channels.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, here's a couple comments from Ellen White. You know, I love her wonderful comments. He believed that Jesus could heal him. He believed he could heal his servant. He had not seen the Savior, but the reports he had heard had inspired him with faith. Notwithstanding the formalism of the Jews, this Roman was convinced that their religion was superior to his own. What kind of religion did he have, by the way?
Pagan Roman, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Pagan Roman, what would that include?
Emperor worship.
Maybe emperor worship, polytheism,
a whole bunch of gods.
But also, you got to take in account where he lived, because he saw the other things happening too.
So. Well, already he had broken through the barriers of national prejudice and hatred that separated the conquerors from the conquered people. And what does the Bible say about him? He built a synagogue for our people, is what they said, told Jesus, right? Jesus immediately set off for the officer's home, but pressed by the multitude, he advanced slowly. The news of his coming preceded him, and the centurion in his self-distrust sent him the message. Still didn't come himself. Lord, trouble not thyself, for I am not worthy that thou shouldest enter under my roof. But the Savior kept coming, kept on his way, and the centurion, venturing at last to approach him, completed the message, saying, "Neither thought I myself worthy to come unto thee, but speak the word only, and my servant shall be healed, for I am a man under authority." We've read that. "As I represent the power of Rome, and my soldiers recognize my authority as supreme, so dost thou represent the power of the infinite God, and all created things obey thy word." Now, I have a question about that. The Roman centurion says, when I want something done, I can command who?
His people.
My servants.
My soldier or one of my servants. And they go and do it. Who did he think Jesus was going to command?
It's hard to say, but I think it would be comparable to angels.
Okay, where did he get the idea about angels?
Well, I don't think the concept was like our concept, maybe, but he had the authority to order, and it happened.
The disciples had gone out healing, the 12, and later the 70, or 72.
Uh-huh. Well, this man lived in Jesus' hometown, so they didn't have to go very far. Ellen White ends up her Desire of Ages section on page 315 to 316 with these words: "He trusted not to his own goodness. His argument was his great need. His faith took hold upon Christ and his true character. He did not believe in him merely as a worker of miracles, but as the friend and savior of mankind." In other words, not just Jews, right? When that centurion needed to have something done, he would send one of his soldiers to accomplish and so forth. Any more comments about where that faith came from, do you think?
Well, we mentioned earlier that he'd interacted with the Jews in a variety of ways, and he figured their religion was better than what he had, which meant that he must have seen what people loathed about the priests and the
Probably.
Other side, and sorted it out in his own mind. He wasn't the fool to get as far as he did, and as far as his own nationality and military.
How do we grow faith in our day? We've already mentioned that the Bible says faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. We make choices each day. Some of those choices bring us nearer to God, and some of those choices take us away from God. The Bible describes those choices which bring us nearer to God as growing faith. How can we be more successful at growing our faith? Well,
and you know, through the Old Testament, many places, God's to the children of Israel, he says, "You don't listen. You don't take instruction." That is the biggest complaint. And you quoted there in Romans, faith comes by hearing. Mm-hmm. And but if people are preoccupied with something else or are satisfied where they're at, it's pretty tough to get through to them.
Yeah. Well, let's look at the next big story. When Jesus noticed the crowd round him, he ordered his disciples to go to the other side of the lake. A teacher of the law came
from where?
I'm sorry, Matthew 8. I'm starting with verse 18. A teacher of the law came to him. A teacher, he said, "I'm ready to go with you wherever you go." Hold on just a minute. I think I've got the wrong. I'm sorry. I wanted to start with verse 25. 23, actually. Jesus got into a boat, and his disciples went with him. Suddenly, a fierce storm hit the lake, and the boat was in danger of sinking. But Jesus was asleep. The disciples went to him and woke him up. "Save us, Lord," they said. "We are about to die." "Why are you so frightened?" Jesus answered. "How little faith you have." Then he got up, ordered the winds and the waves to stop, and there was a great calm. Everyone was amazed. "What kind of man is this?" they said. "Even the winds and the waves obey him." What was going on there? Let's think about the story here for a moment. These boats probably belong to fishermen. Maybe they were Peter's, John's, some of theirs. Maybe there were other boats that they were borrowing, right? These men, especially at least the fishermen among his disciples, had spent their lives fishing on the lake at nighttime, right? So, it was the belief of the Jewish people that only God can control nature and demons. So in this passage, we see Jesus calming a terrible storm. Who do you suppose was responsible for that storm?
The demons?
Satan.
Well, I think there's no doubt about it.
Think about this now. Here's a whole collection of Jesus' closest followers, and Jesus himself and his closest followers, not just the disciples in their boat, but there were other boats around that were close followers. If Satan could have drowned the whole lot of them in one storm, one night, what a triumph that would have been for him, right?
Why would that even be possible?
I didn't say it was possible. That wouldn't prevent Satan from trying it.
I don't know.
The devil brought storms in Job's day.
Yep.
Wiped out all his possessions.
Yeah, I know, but I don't think it was really to destroy him. It was to make them wonder about God, making them deny him or something. Do some weird things that would kind of embarrass Jesus, type of thing. I don't know.
Yeah.
It's just that Satan's got to know that God has every rabbit up his sleeve that anybody could ever have. And I don't know how in the world that just trying to drown those people, that he would even think that he'd have a chance to do that. So I think there's got to be other reasons.
Well, Ellen White thinks
God brought the storm on.
He let it happen, yeah. So might as well.
The angels are far more powerful.
There's a different intent.
I don't think there's a difference. Being passive is not any worse than actually doing it.
So God brought the storm on Job, on Job's family, killed them all.
Well, he let it happen, didn't he?
He let it happen.
Well, that's just like watching the wave come back and not stopping it.
But Gary, you don't want to say that, because what you're actually saying is that everything Satan does is God's responsibility. Now, we're not going to argue about the fact that he allows it. But
didn't you just say that? I mean, didn't you just say the truth right there? Didn't God create Satan?
Idea. It was not God's idea to have a rebellion. Never. It was not a God's idea to have sin.
But he knew it was
going to
happen right at the beginning of time, and you say that.
Yeah, I'm not arguing with that. But there's a very, maybe subtle, but very important difference between allowing something and causing it.
Definitely.
Ephesians 6:12, we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers in the heavenly places. And those heavenly beings, at least those who were swept down by in Revelation 12:4 by the dragon, they have an awful lot of freedom.
Yeah.
And God is the infinite one is our protector. And when he lets us go, that's because we move out of his sphere or realm of protection.
Let me, I hope this doesn't bother you out there in the audience. I really love the way Ellen White fills out these stories. After he, Jesus, had dismissed the multitude, they took him, even as he was, into the boat and hastily set off. Jesus was dog tired. He had been working hard all day, healing people and preaching and so forth. But they were not to depart alone. There were other fishing boats lying near the shore, and these were quickly crowded with people who followed Jesus, eager to still to see and hear him. The sun had set, and the blackness of night settled down upon the stormy sea. The waves, lashed into fury by the howling winds, dashed fiercely upon the disciples' boat and threatened to engulf it. Those hardy fishermen had spent their lives upon the lake and had guided their craft safely through many a storm. But now their strength and skill availed nothing. This is an unusual storm, okay? They were helpless in the grasp of the tempest, and hope failed them as they saw that their boat was filling. Suddenly, a flash of lightning pierces the darkness as they see Jesus lying asleep, undisturbed by the tumult. Try to imagine that. In amazement and despair, they exclaim, "Master, carest thou not that we perish? How can he rest so peacefully while they are in danger, battling with death?" Never did a soul utter that cry unheeded. As the disciples grasp their oars to make a last effort, Jesus rises. He stands in the midst of his disciples while the tempest rages. The waves break over them, and the lightning illuminates his countenance. He lifts his hand, so often employed in deeds of mercy, and says to the angry sea, "Peace, be still." The storm ceases, the billows sink to rest, the clouds roll away, and the stars shine forth. I wonder how long that took.
Don't you see a big lesson here, though?
Yeah, I do.
Big lesson.
Yeah.
And it's a lesson that God could have authored. That is, that we cannot save ourselves. We're under our own power. Isn't that what's happening there?
Well, that's part of what's happening. Yeah.
No, that's everything that's happening.
No, it's not everything
that's happening. I think it's everything that's happening.
No.
Because what is the point of everything else? You cannot be saved under your own power, which a lot of people think they are. Pharisees think they can keep the law under their own power. Yeah. Everybody thinks they can keep everything under their own power.
Well, that's a fatal idea.
Well, how in the world would that lesson have happened if it hadn't have happened?
Well, I told you how I think it happened already.
Well,
I believe the devil wanted to...
Okay, so Satan is the teacher here. So I'm going to teach them that you can't...
No. Satan is a destroyer. He wanted to drown them.
To get rid of Christ.
Yeah.
He took advantage of every
opportunity. But you got to admit, though, that lesson that you can't be saved under your own power wouldn't have happened if that storm hadn't come.
Well, and you've just illustrated a very important point, and that's that God has taken the disaster that we call the Great Controversy, and out of it, he's taught us enormous number of wonderful lessons because think of all the things, all the times when the Sadducees and the Pharisees came to Jesus and they thought they had airtight questions that he couldn't possibly get out of. No matter which way he answered, they were going to trap him. And Jesus comes up with an answer they hadn't even dreamed of. So, and we learn a great principle, see? So, and that's what the devil does all the time. He's trying to just wipe us out. He's trying everything he possibly can to destroy us. And God says, but there's a lesson. And that's basically what you're trying to say, and I agree with that. But it's not, God doesn't have to have the devil's activities to teach us lessons, but he makes use of it and foils the devil again and again. Well, the boat rests upon a quiet sea. Then turning to his disciples, Jesus asks sorrowfully, "Why are you fearful? Have you not yet faith?" I mean, you know, A hush fell upon the disciples. Even Peter did not attempt to express the awe that filled his heart. The boats that had set out to accompany Jesus had been in the same peril with that of the disciples. Terror and despair had seized their occupants, but the command of Jesus brought quiet to the scene of tumult. The fury of the storm had driven the boats into close proximity, and all on board beheld the miracle. In the calm that followed, fear was forgotten. The people whispered among themselves, "What manner of man is this that even the winds and the sea obey him?" Desire of Ages 3:34 to 3:35. Now remember, we start out by saying the Jews believed what? The forces of nature are completely under God's control. Okay? So.
I think Gordon, some years ago or months ago, referred to it as the one God. Everything happens because everything runs back to that.
That's the doctrine, basically, excuse me, that you would get if you had only the books of Moses.
Mm-hmm. Monotheism.
Monotheism. Well, strict, very strict monotheism. Well, the next story, or one of the stories is that comes along, is the when he got to the other side of the, let's just go back here. When he got to the other side of the lake of Sea of Galilee, what happened?
Demoniacs.
Demoniacs. What do we know about the demoniacs? What kind of territory was this?
Gentile territory.
This was Gentile territory. Although there were many Jews living over there, it nevertheless was Gentile territory. So how do you understand the story, the one or two? Matthew says there were two. The other Gospels say there were two. Say there was only one. It's pretty clear, I think, that the one was the man who did most of the talking, but the second guy was right behind him, whose demons were cast out and sent into the 2,000 pigs. It's important to look at the whole picture. So let's go through the sequence real quickly. What happened? They landed on the shore. They were climbing out of the boat. What happened? Here come these demon-possessed men. And, you know, these guys had beaten up on so many people before and bruised them and so forth. You can imagine them come running down the hill and they're ready to attack Jesus. Once again, I'm quite sure that these guys didn't come and do that just by chance. I think the devil knew very well who was coming and tried to stop it. So they came and tried to attack Jesus, and you can imagine the disciples, they probably turned around and head back to the boat as fast as they could go, and Jesus wasn't with them.
No syringes and thorns in those days.
Nope.
Or held all.
Well, you know what I remember happened. The conversation, they said, who are you? Well, we're legion, we're a mob. And Jesus says, get out of you. And they said, well, cast us into those pigs over there. And Jesus says, go ahead. How many pigs were there?
2,000.
And what did the pigs do?
Ran into the water, yeah. Over the cliff.
And then what happened to the people who were responsible for the pigs?
They got disturbed.
They were disturbed. They ran into the village and talked to the owners, said, hey, look what happened. And so what happened? All the whole town came out and said, please, you know, if you're tossing demons around, we don't want you here. Go away from here.
You're costing us our livelihood.
That's yes. Right.
But there's several things that you need to read, that reading between the lines adds to this story. What happened as a result of all that? What did Jesus tell the men to do, by the way?
Well, they wanted to come with him. He said, no, stay here and tell people what God has done for you.
Okay.
And they had lots of time to learn doctrine.
Yes.
Not.
How much?
Maybe a few minutes.
Yeah.
And when Jesus came back later, there were 4,000 men plus women and children that came out to hear him preach, and that's where he fed the 4,000 people.
Who were the first Gentile missionaries?
Those two.
These two gentlemen.
Incredible, huh?
First Gentile missionaries and the first missionaries to the Gentiles.
Yeah. Well, comments from Ellen White. But the purposes of quiet Christ were not thwarted. He allowed the evil spirits to destroy the herd of swine as a rebuke to those Jews who are raising these unclean beasts for the sake of gain. Can you believe that? Had not Christ restrained the demons, they would have plunged into the sea not only the swine, but also their keepers and owners. The preservation of both the keepers and the owners was due alone to his power, mercifully exercised for their deliverance. Furthermore, this event was permitted to take place that the disciples might witness the cruel power of Satan upon both man and beast. Great controversy, not desire of ages this time, great controversy, page 515, paragraph 1. So what was happening there?
Well, I think the men that were insane, they'd been tormented, we don't know how long for, but they'd obviously been tormented for a long time.
Yeah.
And to have somebody, to use modern parlance, turn the switch and suddenly end up free of it, that would catch your attention.
Yeah.
It really would.
By the way, I have an interesting question here for you. Probably nobody has the answer to it, but it's something to think about. The Sea of Galilee is about, I don't know, 4 or 5 miles wide. I think it's 8 miles wide and 12 miles long. So it's a big lake, but it's not a huge ocean or something. If you drowned, if you're a very strict Jew and you don't have anything to do with pigs, and all of a sudden you find out that 2,000 pigs have been drowned. Pigs have been drowned in this sea.
In the lake.
How long would it be before you would drink from the water or eat any of the fish? Anyway, if we stop and think for a moment, Satan is hoping to control the whole world at the end of this earth's history. Remember those words from Revelation 13. One of the heads of the beast seemed to have been fatally wounded, but the wound had healed. The whole earth was amazed and followed the beast. Everyone worshiped the dragon because he had given his authority to the beast. They worshiped the beast also, saying, who's like the beast? Who can fight against it? And then verses 7 and 8 basically repeat the idea. It was allowed to fight against God's people and to defeat them, and it was given authority over every tribe, nation, language, and race. All people living on earth will worship it. Worship what?
The beast.
And the dragon, right? Except those whose names are written before the creation of the world in the book of the living, so forth. What will the people act like who are demon-possessed in the end?
There's a big range there of their behavior. A big range.
Uh-huh. You can tell us about that.
Well, it's one thing to be a drunkard, and it's another thing, and that can get you into trouble, kill people, kill themselves, mm-hmm. to full demon possession where they're tremendously powered and yeah. running around killing people
yeah.
and the likes.
Well, we're told. Yeah, go ahead.
You talk about, behold, I knock at the door.
Mm-hmm.
That's kind of what happens, will happen at the end of the time, don't you think, that either God will come in mm-hmm. or Satan will. And yeah. there's not going to be anything neutral about it.
Yeah.
It's going to be one or the other. And if Satan's there, he's going to be full blast.
Which side is the majority going to be on?
The devil's side.
The majority on this earth, anyway.
Yeah.
Yes.
If we take the whole universe, the majority are on God's side.
Okay. Has the time come for us to think very seriously about these stories and also about our own future?
You've only got to look at the papers every morning and you realize it is time.
Mm-hmm. Well, the next story. We're looking at a variety of miracles here. Matthew 9. Jesus got into the boat and went back across the lake to his own town, where some people brought to him a paralyzed man lying on a bed. When Jesus saw how much faith they had, he said to the paralyzed man, "Courage, my son, your sins are forgiven." Then some teachers of the law said to themselves, "This man is speaking blasphemy." Jesus perceived what they were thinking, so he said, "Why are you thinking such evil things? Is it easier to say your sins are forgiven or to say, get up and walk? I will prove to you then that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins." So he said to the paralyzed man, "Get up, pick up your bed, and go home." The man got up and went home. When the people saw it, they were afraid and praised God for giving such authority to people. Okay, so what do we know about the rest of this story? If you compare the other Gospels and Ellen White. The man lives...
For thousands of years, uh-huh. God's people thought, with good reason, that disease came because of sin.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
If you're blessed by God, you'll be healthy, wealthy, and wise. If you're cursed by God because you're a sinner, you'll have disease and you'll be poor.
Okay.
That's so if any in the Old Testament.
So if any serious illness is a result of sin, either of the person himself or of his parents, if you look at John 9, that's what the disciples said to Jesus, wasn't it? Was this man sin or his parents? Because he's born blind. Thus, it would be impossible to heal anyone in their thinking unless one dealt with the sin problem first, right? And so Ellen White says these words, "It was not physical restoration that this paralyzed man desired so much as relief from the burden of sin. He knew that he'd lived a sinful life, but he'd come to believe the teachings of the Pharisees. And so he just believed that absolutely he's condemned, right? If he could see Jesus and receive the assurance of forgiveness and peace with heaven, he would be content to live or die according to God's will." Desire of Ages 267. Well, what happened? Remember, this man was about to die. He was really in bad shape. He couldn't walk. He couldn't. So they had to carry him. He got some friends who brought him there. And what did they find when they got to Capernaum?
It was too crowded. They couldn't get near Christ.
There's a lot of other people wanted to get next to Jesus too, right?
Mm-hmm.
What did they finally do?
Went up on the outside steps, put a hole in the roof and lowered him down.
We're pretty sure this was Peter's house. And we have a fair idea where Peter's house was. I've been there and taken pictures of the place. They tore a hole in the roof and let the man down right in front of Jesus. And he was watching very closely to see what Jesus would do.
The Pharisees and company.
Okay. There's more to the story than what we read superficially. The rabbis had waited anxiously to see, this is Ellen White again, the rabbis had waited anxiously to see what disposition Christ would make of this case. They recollected how the man had appealed to them for help, and they had refused him hope or sympathy. Not satisfied with this, they had declared that he was suffering the curse of God for his sins. So what good had they done for him?
Zero.
These things came fresh to their minds when they saw the sick man before them. They marked the interest with which all were watching the scene, and they felt a terrible fear of losing their own influence over the people. What a surprise. These dignitaries did not exchange words together, but looking into each other's faces, they read the same thought in each, that something must be done to arrest the tide of feeling. Jesus had declared that the sons of the paralytic were forgiven. The Pharisees caught at these words as blasphemy and conceived that they could present this as a sin worthy of death. They said in their hearts, "He blasphemeth. Who can forgive sin but one, even God?" And they just set themselves up for a trap on themselves, didn't they? Mm-hmm. Fixing his glance upon them, beneath which they cowered and drew back, Jesus said, "Wherefore think ye evil in your hearts? For whether is it easier to say, 'Thy sins be forgiven thee,' or to say, 'Arise and walk?'" So if you believe that the disease is caused by sin, what do you have to do?
Forgive the sin.
You have to deal with the sin if you want the person to be well, right? "But that ye may know that the Son of Man hath power on earth to forgive sins," he said, turning to the paralytic, "arise, take up thy bed, and go into thine house." Then he who had been born on a litter to Jesus rises to his feet with the elasticity and strength of youth. The life-giving blood bounds through his veins. Every organ of his body springs into sudden activity. The glow of health succeeds the pallor of approaching death. And immediately he arose, took up the bed, and went forth before them all, insomuch that they were all amazed and glorified God, saying, "We never saw it on this fashion." The paralytic found in Christ healing for both the soul and the body. The spiritual healing was followed by physical healing, physical restoration. This lesson should not be overlooked. There are today thousands suffering from physical disease who, like the paralytic, are longing for the message, "Thy sins are forgiven." I'm very happy to tell you that at the clinic where I work, we have a group of people who come from time to time. I mean, they have their scheduled rotations that are there just to be with people, to talk to them, and to pray with them. We call them our spiritual ambassadors. Going back, the burden of sin with its unrest and unsatisfied desires is the foundation of their maladies. They can find no relief until they come to the healer of the soul. The peace which he alone can give would impart vigor to the mind and health to the body. Desire of Ages 268 to 270. We don't find those kinds of miracles happening very much in our day. Why do you think that is? I mean, don't we have sick people today?
Yeah.
I've raised this question before, but think about it for a moment. Suppose someone with the power of God, Jesus himself or someone like Jesus who had miracle-working power, could step into our hospital just over down the block here and just walk through the hospital and heal everybody. Like he did whole villages in Galilee. What do you think would happen? The first question I want you to answer is this. What would the newspapers say the next morning?
"If you want to be healed, I know a man."
Okay.
It could go two ways. It could make a whole lot of bad, or it'll try and just cover it over.
I don't think they could ignore something like that. You got hundreds of people in a hospital, and all of a sudden, a lot of them close to death, and now they're walking around healthy.
I would agree. On the other hand, they'd have to move them out, and there'd be another 900 coming right behind them.
Well, that's the next question, you see. How would they report it? And then the next question was, what would all the sickest people do from all the hospitals around?
Yeah.
They would be right here immediately, wouldn't they? I mean, just think about it.
Well, that's what kind of happened with Jesus, wasn't it?
Yeah.
I mean, people just showed up all over the place, from different countries even, mm-hmm. from different lands they even heard about it, and they came.
Well, wouldn't God create a great stir? I mean, wouldn't he get a lot of attention for the Adventist Church if he just started healing people at the Loma Linda University Medical Center?
They might be attracted for the wrong reason.
Isn't physical healing a good reason for being attracted?
You bet. But it needs to be more than that.
Okay. There's a couple of other men. We're running out of time here. A couple of other men that came to Jesus and had some interesting things to say. Look at Matthew 8, going back to verse 18. When Jesus noticed the crowd round him, he ordered his disciples to go to the other side of the lake. We already talked about that event. A teacher of the law came to him. Teacher, he said, I'm ready to go with you wherever you go. Jesus answered him, foxes have holes and birds have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lie down and rest. What do you think? How do you think of the man responded to that?
Well, I think it's a little bit like the rich young ruler.
Yeah.
What do you think he was saying when he said that?
A scribe would have been living quite handsomely, I would think.
Yeah.
And Christ was saying, I don't know where I'm going to lay my head down any day, any night.
Yeah.
Do you want to be in it or not? Mm-hmm. I think he probably got discouraged about it.
By the way, just as a side note, who did sort of support Jesus? Do you remember?
The women.
Yeah. Women?
Yeah. Luke 8.
Where do you get that idea? Look at Luke 8, 1-3. Sometime later, Jesus traveled through towns and villages preaching the good news about the kingdom of God. The 12 disciples went with him, and so did some women who had been healed of evil spirits and diseases. Mary, who was called Magdalene, from whom 7 demons had been driven out, Joanna, whose husband Chusa was an officer in Herod's court, I mean, this was a high society lady, and Susanna and many other women who used their own resources to help Jesus and his disciples. Who's supporting Jesus and his disciples?
Rich.
By the way, I have asked this before, and I don't want to be suggesting wrong things here at all, but how would you feel if your pastor was traveling around with a formerly demon-possessed prostitute and a bunch of society women?
Raise a few eyebrows.
Raise a few eyebrows. Oh, man. Well, the second man said, please, Jesus, let me go and bury my father, and then I'll come and follow you. And what did Jesus say? Let the dead bury their bed. They're dead. Let the dead bury their dead, or come and follow me. Isn't that kind of harsh?
No, he was pointing out he had a choice to make. In Jewish law, they had to be buried within 24 hours. You either do that or you come with me.
So if the fact the man was there following Jesus, we know almost for sure that his father was not dead. Mm-hmm. As he would be back, because they would have to take care of it within 24 hours. So what the man was really saying is, one of these times my father's going to pass away, and then I'm going to have to deal with all of his estate and all that kind of stuff. And when I get done with all that, I'll come and follow you. And what is Jesus saying? We don't have time for that. By that time, I'll be long gone.
Now or never.
Well, we've already studied how Jesus called four fishermen. What were their names?
Peter, Andrew, James, and John.
Okay, they were called from their boats. They left all and followed him. But now we notice he called in someone else in Matthew 9, verses 9 to 13. And who was it?
Matthew.
Jesus left that place, and as he walked along, he saw a tax collector named Matthew sitting in his office. He said to him, follow me. Matthew got up and followed him. Now, what kind of situation would be Matthew in? I mean, where would these tax collectors be sitting? What were they doing?
He was working for the opposition, you might say, in a open place where the crowds were coming by.
These people, they basically had tax booths along the road,
yeah,
because their main source of income was all the people coming and going. You want to come into town with a big load of fish that you just caught? Okay, pay your tax. If you want to come, if you're traveling from Syria to Egypt, okay, you're coming through this way, pay your tax. So Jesus walks along. So all of his income would be where? Probably they're sitting beside him
with him.
And what did he do when Jesus said, follow me?
Left it all, apparently.
Left it all and followed Jesus. What did he do shortly thereafter?
He threw a big feast for Jesus.
Matthew threw a big feast for Jesus, and he invited what kind of people?
Fellow tax collectors.
A lot of tax collectors and other outcasts. And some Pharisees saw this and asked his disciples, why does your teacher eat with such people? I mean, we are way above that, right? Jesus heard them and answered, people who are well do not need a doctor, but only those who are sick. Go and find out what is meant by the scriptures that says, it was kindness that I want and not animal sacrifices. I have not come to call respectable people, but outcasts. Okay. Well, the Old Testament is very clear on what God wants. Look at a couple of verses as we're closing. Hosea 6:6 says, I want your constant love, not your animal sacrifices. I would rather have my people know me than burn offerings to me. And the one that's probably more famous, Micah 6:6-8. What shall I bring to the Lord, the God of heaven, when I come to worship him? Shall I bring the best calves to burn as offerings to him? Will the Lord be pleased if I bring him thousands of sheep or endless streams of olive oil? Shall I offer my firstborn child to pay for my sins? No, the Lord has told us what is good. What he requires of us is this, to do what is just, to show constant love, and to live in humble fellowship with our God. That's what God really wants. It's not the rounds of ceremonies and all kinds of sacrifices and so forth like this. What God really wants is he wants us to live lives of righteousness by treating other people of all kinds equally and fairly and with love in our hearts. And I hope that that will be our experience in this coming week. Our kind and loving Father, what a wonderful opportunity as we have to open your word and look at these stories and think about you. There's so much we could say. We thank you for the information that we do have and for the wonderful experiences of those who had the privilege of living when you were here on this earth. We know you're coming back again soon. May we be ready for that event is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.